is the promise that we claim. Okay. So, the title of today's sermon is Be Salty! Exclamation point. Salty can mean someone who has a dirty mouth, foul language, someone who swears a lot, someone that's not what I'm talking about. I'm not talking about being salty that way. But that our lives should be like salt. We should show the character of salt. The characteristics of salt should be in our lives. So go ahead and look up Matthew chapter 5, verse 13. And I'll give you 1 minute to go ahead and find those verses. Matthew chapter 5, verse 13. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and sign the verses. Matthew chapter 5, verse 13, it says, "You are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? It is then good for nothing but to be thrown out and trampled underfoot by men." Let's pray. Father in heaven, help us to have a heart that is tender, eyes that are alert, minds that are awake and thinking, spirit that is ready to converse and interact with you. I pray that you would help us to be attentive to the challenge that we have today, the challenge of being salty. I thank you for the sermon from Jesus Christ, the best preacher ever, and I pray that we would be humble at your feet and learning from you today. I pray that you'd help me to preach the word clearly and apply it to our lives so that we can become more like you. In Jesus' name, amen. So, salt. Salt is important. One of the most important things in the world. Did you know that? When we think of salt, what do we normally think of? Right? Is that what we think of usually? Table salt. Yes? Table salt is a pretty common thing everywhere. You know, in the South, during the winter time, when it snows and there's ice, people might think that they need to run outside and pour table salt all over their yards to help the ice melt. No, that's not the kind of salt that goes outside. It doesn't quite work that way. In the North, we know better. We use a different kind of salt, right? It's not table salt. We have a special kind of salt that's poured on the roads to help the ice melt. In the garage, I have a big bag of salt that it's actually for water softener. It's water softener salt. Our neighbor gave it to me. He said it works for melting the snow off. So I use that sometimes. But salt is very important to have. In our house, in our own house, we have several kinds of salt. I just showed you one of them, the table salt. It's a regular table salt right there. We have sea salt. I personally like this a lot. But actually, sea salt is not what is in here. It's actually table salt in here right now. But it used to be sea salt. We have kosher salt. this because I started to use a cast iron pan, and I read that the best way to clean it is not to clean it with dish detergent. It's better to use a little bit of salt because it's coarse, and so it helps get rid of dirt and grime that's left in the pan. Now we have this box, also of kosher salt, this whole box. It's the same stuff. I bought it. I forgot that I had it. I was planning on using it for canning. You know, when you pan pickles and cucumbers? Oh, last year we had a lot of them. And so we made a lot of, we needed a lot of salt for preservative. But this is coarse, that means it's bigger. And then there's, I used a bunch of kosher salt for a turkey. I'll explain that to you in a little bit. I've got some of this. This morning I quickly drove over to my sister and brother-in-law's home because they have pink Himalayan salt. I know that they like to use that, so I asked for a little bit of it. It was nice they gave that to me. This is pink salt. You know, the Himalayan salt, I think it's also called mood salt. I don't know, they're supposed to, if you boil it in some water, it's supposed to help your mood feel better. I don't know. Is that true? I don't know. That's the question. So, but there's all kinds of different salts and they have different purposes. So is my sermon point today to teach you about different kinds of salt? No. But it is to challenge you to look at what are the, how salt works to influence the world and what kind of characteristics we are to have to influence the world. So, first of all, we talk about salt, right? So, you know, people sign salt. Salt is usually the idea of just table salt, right? You know, pour it on your food or whatever, but salt, there's a lot of different kinds, so I'll probably just finger spell it. During Christ's time, did they have table salt? No. Their salt was different than what we have now today. So that's, Christ wasn't thinking of table salt, and he used this as an example. So we see the context here in Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 through 12. Remember, Jesus was on the mount, and he came and sat on the mountain there, and his disciples gathered to him. And then in verse 2, it says Jesus began his talk, verses 3 to 12. And that's the Beatitudes, that Jesus was explaining about the poor in spirit. Blessed are the poor in spirit, those who know they need Jesus. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek. They realize they have to submit and they can't get along without Christ. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Those who desire to know Jesus more. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall show mercy, or for they shall obtain mercy. And then let's see. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are those who experience persecution. So we've seen the Sermon on the Mount, and now right away, Jesus says, you are salt. You are the salt of the earth. You are the salt of the earth. That was a very quick transition. What he says next after the Beatitudes, that was for people who belong to the kingdom of God. Those who are born again are to exhibit these characteristics, what are shown in verse 12. And so the characteristics that we have are going to be influencing others, just as salt has an influence. Now if you look at the geography of Israel, Jesus wasn't speaking out of context. Jesus knew where he lived, and he knew where the people came from, and the kinds of houses that they had. He knew how to talk to fishermen. He knew how to talk to everyone. He could draw upon people's experience to make a point in his teaching. So the area where Jesus was teaching, where he delivered the Sermon on the Mount, they were by the Sea of Galilee. It was a fresh water source. The Jordan River flows from various hills and mountains and comes down into the Dead Sea. And everyone is familiar with the salt from the Dead Sea. If you've ever been to Jerusalem, you would be able to know that area is quite dry. It's a desert, and you can even taste the salt there. So in the Dead Sea region is quite low. It's one of the lowest points in the world, actually, because it's below sea level. The Dead Sea is very low, and then on either side of it, it has, you know, hills and mountains. And so I'll show you a picture of a place called Jebel Ustum, Jebelustum, and that's where they believe perhaps Sodom used to be. Remember the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah that God utterly destroyed? Some people believe that's the location of where those cities used to be. Oh, seems someone's outside and Goosebumps barking. Okay, so up here, see that white up there? It's been called Mount Sodom. And I'll show you another picture. So this is the area around the Dead Sea. You can see how there's cliffs up there. And this is the southern part of the sea here. So it's mountains that are of rock salt. It's 2 to 3 miles wide, several miles long, and 700 feet tall. And that's that area all around the Dead Sea. It's full of rock salt. I'll show you one more image. This pillar is known as Lot's wife. People say that it looks like it. My dad said, "My dad, if you're watching, can you confirm? Have you seen this site? Have you been there to see that yourself?" Some people say that that is, you know, in this story of Sodom and Gomorrah, when the angels came to rescue Lot, his two daughters and his wife, they instructed them. They said, "Don't look back. Do not turn back." But then Lot's wife turned around and looked and became a pillar of salt. And some people say, that's Lot's wife right there. Well, okay, you can, you know, I'm sure it would be allowed, but if you wanted to dig through and see if there was a body in there, I don't know. Ugh. Anyway. But this is all made of salt. It's really not useful, though. It's really not used for anything. This kind of salt is not of much benefit. It's not for becoming table salt. It's not good for preserving food. So it's considered not good for anything. The one thing it is good for is farmland. You know, if you have your paths that you walk on between your farm fields, and you pour this kind of salt on the paths, and then as the rain falls on it, it helps harden the soil so that it makes almost like a cement-like mixture so that it becomes hard. So people would throw this out on the ground. And it does have, there's another kind of salt. So Jesus said, "You are the salt of the earth." He's not talking about this kind of salt here in the Dead Sea. There's another kind of salt that he's talking about. But if you don't have any flavor, you're going to become like this salt here, demonstrated like from the Dead Sea area. just good for being walked on. My dad commented and said, yes, I did see that. Okay, good. I said the right thing. I hope that someday I can go and see that, go and tour the Holy Land. I would love that. All right, so functions of salt. There are several functions. What does salt do? Salt is used for preservation. When I can, we have to put salt in it. A couple years ago, I canned tomatoes. We had a lot of tomatoes, and we canned a lot of them, and you have to include salt. I think it's a teaspoonful in every jar. If you leave the salt out, the food can ruin. It helps the food stay and last longer. That's very important. Who loves pickles? You know, one of my favorites is Clausen. Yep, you like pickles? Oh, I love it better. Clausen is my favorite kind of pickle. Anyway, it needs salt. It helps to preserve it. You remember that there was no refrigeration at this time in Christ's day. And so often food was rubbed with salt or buried in salt. It would be put in barrels and salted that way, covered in salt. Or maybe salt would be mixed together with water and food would be soaked in that to become a preservative. The disciples, four of the 12, were fishermen, and they would catch fish. Often they would immediately put the fish into salt to preserve. For us, we don't think about that. You know, we get our fish out and we go home and butcher it and put it on the grill or put it in the cooler. You know, we use ice as a preservative. We keep it cold, we keep it refrigerated. But back then, they kept it salted. That was a means of preservation. And also preservation, it helps prevent decay. So salt was incredibly important for that. And of course, Americans know that salt is good for flavor, right? Mm-hmm. Salt is great. You know, if you've got broccoli or green beans or spaghetti squash that we ate yesterday, right? Does it taste better with salt? Maybe. Anna hates that. I think we forgot to put salt on it yesterday. We don't want too much, but just a little. Nora says she put barbecue sauce on it. So that helped the flavor. But salt is good for seasoning. Meat, you don't have to do much to meat. You don't have to inject it and marinate it and all kinds of things. You just add a little bit of salt and it's wonderful. So salt is good for seasoning, for adding flavor, giving it a spice, giving it a taste. Salt is also used for healing. In the Bible, I'll show two examples. Elisha had some bad water. And so Elisha had said, go ahead and put some salt in there. Of course, God is definitely a part of cleaning the water here in this process. But, you know, salt does help clean things. In Ezekiel, there's a verse that talks about how when a baby is born, it is rubbed with a salt and water mixture to help it. You know, I know that we use salt for sore throats. I remember when the coronavirus started, people said, it seems it's a myth, it said, go ahead and drink water, swish it around, gargle it, and then spit it back out occasionally. Okay. Well, anyway, so I remember, you know, when I had teeth pulled, my mom said, you need to get warm water and mix it with salt, swish it around, and it was really salty. But swish it around and spit it back out because the salt helps your gums to heal. So it acts as an antiseptic. So interesting. Salt, though, can be an irritant. You know, as I said, I was swishing that water around. So it helps in that sense. But if someone says to rub salt in your wound, you know, that's a hearing phrase, to rub salt in your wound. If you have a sore or a cut and you put salt in it, it makes it feel so much worse. You know, if you're rubbing it in, rubbing in some salt, it becomes an irritant too. And I was explaining before that I used kosher salt to rub into the meat. It helps it really get in. It helps, on the iron pan, the salt, coarse salt, can help cleanse. And then remember I told you that I was going to tell you about my turkey. I love Weber Grill. They should pay me to advertise. Man, I love my Weber Grill. And my dad, someone gave me a gas grill and I used it for a while, but it just didn't taste, it didn't have a good flavor. So I started using the Weber Grill. Oh man, I can't use the gas grill anymore. You know, if you use gas, that's totally fine. That's whatever, that's fine. I'm not against that at all, but my family, we use the Weber kettle. All right. So children, if someday you're gonna marry a guy and you wanna impress me, make sure he knows how to grill. And if not, we'll have to convert them too. Anyway, so for Thanksgiving this last year, you know, turkeys often are baked in the oven for Thanksgiving, right? And they get pretty dry. And I get real tired of dry turkey. So I did some investigation, and there's a website that I was looking at, Weber Kettle Grill Fans, and they suggested, you know, my Weber grill, and I don't have a huge one, so they suggested get a bag, fill it with water, apple juice, and salt, 1 cup of salt, kosher salt. That's why I have a whole box of it, because I needed a lot of it. Pour it in there, stick the turkey in there with other herbs and spices, tie that bag up, and leave it to soak for 24 hours. And the result, the best. It was moist. It was good. One of the best turkeys I've ever had. Because the salt penetrated into the meat. Nora and Tally both say, yeah, it was excellent. So the salt really soaked through the meat and left it moist. Left it amazing. Make you hungry? I'm sorry about that. But, you know, ham can do the same thing. Ham uses a lot of salt. So sometimes salt can have the opposite effect, you know, for those who struggle with high blood pressure or other ailments, salt can be a problem. That's part of the American diet that's not good for us, but salt has all these different functions. Now, the challenge of salt. Jesus said, you are the salt of the earth. So who's the earth and who's the salt? Well, you are the salt. Those who are kingdom, who are citizens of the kingdom of heaven, you are salt. What does that mean? The word retardant here is a word that means to reduce, to quench. So a retardant means to help put out. You know, when you are spraying fire retardant on fire, it means to help prevent, to, you know, from the world's mind and the world's philosophy, the world's view, what the world says, what the world does, it is all corrupted by sin. It's full of corruption. And that started with Adam and Eve. When they sinned against God, when they broke God's commandment, do not eat from the tree of life. And they went ahead and ate. That impacted the world. And our minds, our speech, our actions. the way we see things is all corrupted by sin. And Jesus said, you are the salt of the earth. That means that you are the retardant to the decay of the world because of sin. Imagine a world without Christians. What would that be like? Maybe what I just said is highly controversial, but I believe that Christians, the religion as taught by Jesus, as taught by his apostles, as taught following God's word, I believe that men and women are more equal that way. The Bible teaches that husbands should love their wives, and wives should honor their husbands, submit to their husbands, and that seems so unequal. But God made different roles for husbands and wives to make them equal. If we take God's plan for his people, it's good. Slavery. In the Bible, yes. In the New Testament, it does talk about people who were slaves, yes. But the emphasis there is, in Christ you are free. So people who were slaves and not in Christ, that thinking it's true that even today there are still slaves around the world today with human trafficking. It's an awful, awful thing. It's even here in America. So you, as a Christian, can be a retardant to the decay of the world. Christians also preserve what is holy. What God clearly commands in his word, we are to follow. We're to do that. And so we preserve what is good in that way. For example, our society, our world, we have abortion. It's murder. And we as Christians, we say, well, okay, whatever. It's just how it is. That should not be our perspective as Christians. You know, with elderly people, well, whatever, just let them die. No, we should treasure and care for life. We should always be seeking the best. Christians, today, this many hospitals actually have been established by strong Christian groups. You know, the names of hospitals often named, I used to work at a hospital, the Good Samaritan Hospital. They're often very biblical or Christian type names. There's St. Mary's, there's all different kinds of hospitals. There are Baptist hospitals and Presbyterian hospitals and Catholic hospitals, because they were founded on a principle of the value of life, the sanctity of human life. So salt preserves what is good. Salt preserves what is holy. Our Constitution, our American Constitution, grants us the freedom of religion. That's an example of the effect of the Christian way of thinking on the government. So does freedom of religion means that every American has the right to to believe or not believe. The Bible never teaches that you are forced to be a Christian. It leaves it up to the person to make the choice whether they're going to be a follower of Christ or not. So salt preserves the good in that. Salt often makes things better. Christians should be one of the best speakers. Christians should be one of the most intelligent people in the world. They should. Christians should be some of the most energetic people in the world. The best authors, the best whatever you can name, because they should be great for God. That's the effect of salt. Salt, when you eat salt, like let's say you're eating some chips, you often get thirsty, right? If you eat salty food, do you usually get thirsty? Yeah? No? Talia says no. Yeah, I don't believe you, Talia. But as a Christian, I should draw people and cause them to be more thirsty for Christ, have that influence on them to want Christ. We talk about how salt brings flavor. Christians should bring flavor to Christ. That's the influence that they have, so that people realize that's what it means to be a Christian. Oh. Now, that leads to our next point. Salt that is not salty. Look again at Matthew chapter 5, verse 13. You are the salt of the earth. We talked about that in point number one. But if the salt loses its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? How does it get its flavor back? And that's what we have to think about. Can salt lose its flavor? Again, Jesus was using the idea of this being a possibility. He said, if salt loses its flavor. Salt doesn't usually simply lose its flavor, become tasteless. It usually lasts for a very long time. So how does it become tasteless? Well, it could be adulterated. That means it could have something else mixed in with it that makes the salt lose its flavor, lose the saltiness. Or it could become diluted. You know, if you put it in too much water and you haven't added enough salt, so that the taste diminishes. So it's possible that salt can lose its flavor if it's diluted in that way. It's been changed because of what it mixes with or because of what it's been exposed to. So that makes me think of 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 through 17. 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 through 17. It says, love not the world. Do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, which includes the world's philosophies, the world's way of thinking, the world's behavior, its separation from God, if you love that, anything of the world, the love of the Father, if you love the world, then the love of the Father is not in him. So what does that look like? Verse 16, for all that is in the world, this is split up into three categories, the lust of the flesh, that would be sensual lusts, you know, what your body craves, what your body wants, things that don't honor God, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. Those are not of the Father, but are of the world. When the devil tempted Jesus in Matthew chapter 4, the devil tried to remind Jesus, he said, Jesus, you're hungry, right? You've been 40 days without food. So all you have to do is just tell these rocks to become bread and you can go ahead and eat. And Jesus said, no, man depends on every word that comes from God's mouth. A man needs that more than food. So the devil was appealing to Jesus' fleshly needs, his need to eat. And then the lust of the eyes. The devil took Jesus up onto a mountaintop and he showed him the kingdoms of the world. And he said, Jesus, he said, look at all these kingdoms of the world. Look at all this. I'll give it to you. You can have it if you bow to me. I'll give it to you. It appeals to the lust of the eyes. Everything out there that you can have. Oh, did I switch that? No, hang on. Yeah, I think I switched the order of the temptations anyway. So, it appealed to the pride of life that he could control it. And then also, he went up to the top of the temple and he said, Jesus, go ahead and fall. Go ahead and jump off. And your angels will be sure to come and bear you up and catch you so that you don't fall and hurt yourself. And Jesus said, stop tempting me, for the scriptures say you will not tempt the Lord your God. And when we allow worldly temptations to influence us, Jesus wouldn't allow that. He wouldn't allow that kind of thinking, the systems of the world, the worldview, the things of the world. Those are not going to continue forever. The world is passing away and the lust of it. But he who does the will of God abides forever. Those who love the world, they pass away. That's the desalting process. It becomes no good. So we talked about how some salt can be kind of bland, right? Just kind of plain and bland. A Christian who says he follows Christ can be bland, not have any influence on anyone else. And a bland Christian is easily ignored by the world because that Christian is not actively trying to reduce the decay of the world, not actively salting the world. That kind of Christian is not influential. That kind of Christian, you can't see a difference between the world and this follower of Christ. I want you to think about your own thoughts, your own words and actions. What really makes you happy? The world says, do these things and you'll be happy. You can have entertainment and movies and that will make you happy. You can go to parties and that will make you happy. Alcohol will make you happy. The commercials never show what happens after you're done being drunk. The commercials never show someone having a hangover and throwing up. Everyone's happy and partying and life is great. Where it's funny and, man up, drink Bud Light, whatever. They don't show the effects of a DUI. They don't show the effects and the devastation and destruction of people's lives. Just be happy. That's important. Just take pleasure. We take pleasure in reading books. Just be happy. Read. They'll make you happy. You can detach from the world for a while. Or, instead just sit back and there's Netflix. Christians are to be different than the world, be different in their way of thinking. Our happiness is in Christ Jesus. Our pleasure is in serving God. When trials come, are we different in our reactions than unsaved people? You know, when we have this coronavirus time, are we all up in arms and not knowing what to do? And or are we just trusting Christ and we say, oh, we're so mad at the government and look at what they're doing? I know there's a lot of different issues and views on this. But we are citizens of heaven. Don't forget that. So our view should be different than the view of the world. Our ethics, that means the rules that we have, our inner guiding principles of life for how we work. Christians should be different than the world. You know, when the world just skates by and does, hangs back and takes advantage of work and doesn't really do it, a Christian needs to be different than that. Compassion. We should be known as a compassionate people. Our reaction to catastrophe. Do we have meltdowns or we withdraw or we fight? Our reaction should be different. We know that we can trust Christ. I'll give you a short, brief situation. Friday evening. I went to Little Caesar's Pizza and I ordered something. I went in, my family was waiting in the van. I went in and placed my order. Wrote it, it was understood, it was, you know. So I had to go outside and wait because, you know, they have, you know, the social distancing thing. So I went outside and I was waiting and I waited for a while. Someone else came in, she had a mask on and, you know, she looked like she might have possibly been a healthcare worker. She placed her order. And then I saw that it looked like my order was there on the counter. So I was ready to wave and say, hey, that might be my order, but I didn't. And so then that woman came in. Remember, I had ordered first. She came in after me. That woman came in, took her order, and then she took the other thing on the counter too and left. And I thought, wait a minute, I was there first. It looks like we ordered the same thing. But I was there first. And she left. So I, you know, kind of was looking in the window with a quizzical expression on my face, and then, you know, the person came out with a note saying, oh, I'm sorry, the orders got confused and your order's delayed, you have to wait for another 7 minutes. I got upset. I was upset. I wasn't happy. And I said, forget it. And I left, and I was kind of angry. And I got home, and I realized, you know, I was wrong. That was the wrong reaction. I should have been salty. I should have been different than being angry. So I told my wife, I have to go back. And I apologized. You know, the person knew that she made a mistake, you know. I've made many mistakes. We need to show grace and be gracious. So I apologized and said, I'm sorry, I should have reacted better than that and had more patience. Please forgive me. You know, it's easy to swallow our pride. Well, I don't really know who that person is anyway, and so I'm not going to interact with them again. And no, being salty means I said, if I could wait, I could have reacted differently, but I didn't. So I had to go back and apologize. They did fix my order and they gave me something else too, so maybe they did forgive me. But we have to learn from our mistakes, and we are to be salt of the earth. Now the next week in a related, this sermon continues, but it talks about being light of the earth instead. All right, so now, if something has lost its saltiness, can it be re-salted? Remember, Christ said, if something can lose its flavor, how can it be seasoned again? You know, so this question kind of leaves the possibility that the saltiness can be returned, that salt can can gain its flavor again. If a Christian truly is a follower of Christ and has lost his salt, but realizes later that I haven't been following Christ truly and repents, this person can regain his flavor, yes, can regain the saltiness. But what is the end for someone who has lost his flavor? It is then good for nothing, but to be thrown out and trampled underfoot by men. And we gave the example of the farm field, that, you know, the salt became a way to build highways, to build hardened, packed earth. We can't use this for preservative, we can't use it for flavor, so okay, we'll throw it out. But if a Christian becomes so apathetic that he loses his flavor for Christ, he loses his enjoyment of Christ and becomes so entrapped by the world and entangled with his own desires that he loses his saltiness, that person becomes unprofitable. Can you imagine being labeled unprofitable? Every Christian is accountable to Christ. Think about your family and your friends. How are you influencing them? Are you truly making a difference? Do they know that you are a follower of Christ, or can they not even really tell? You know, if someone dies and you show up at the funeral and, you know, they say, oh, you're a Christian, I didn't even realize. Or if you, we should be influencing others for Christ. All right, and then thirdly, healthy salt. Remember I talked about the pink salt. I have the pink salt here. People say it's so healthy because it's got different minerals in here and it's so good for you. You know, it doesn't cause your blood pressure to go up. And, you know, it's kind of funny because I was talking with Sam this morning, my brother-in-law, you know, the one who gave me the salt. He said, you know, some of the comments that they talk about, it doesn't cause high blood pressure. That's not true. Any salt can cause high blood pressure. But some people say that the pink Himalayan salt is a better mineral and it's, you know, maybe the flavor is better. That's probably true. You know, it might be better than other kinds of salt, but I don't think there's a whole lot of difference between each different kind of salt.
Nope.
Oh, these are similar. All right, so our sea salt, our table salt, our kosher salt, which is the healthiest? I don't know. But the point is that salt has saltiness. And so Christians ought to be salty. Let me go back just briefly to number two. When we lose our salt, sometimes we can have too much salt, right? That we come to the point of being pushy. We come to the point of, you know, coming after someone over and over. You need to be saved, and getting after them, and it's a real turnoff. Pointing out errors to people constantly. Oh, you know, that's not your sin, and look at this sin, and look at that sin. That's not the point. Our flavor should be showing Christ instead of constantly picking and fussing, and you can lose your influence that way and another way. Okay, so now, healthy salt. There are three points to healthy salt. First, have peace with one another. Remember, Jesus said, blessed are the peacemakers. And Jesus was encouraging peace with one another. And here are several verse references for this. Mark chapter 9, verse 49 through 50, for everyone will be seasoned with fire. And every every sacrifice will be seasoned with salt. Salt is good, but if the salt loses its flavor, how will you season it? Have salt in yourselves and have peace with one another. Now that is the last statement. Have peace with one another. It doesn't seem to go together with the rest of the passage. In order to understand it, you have to look at the broader context. Look at verse 42. It says, whoever causes one of these little ones who believe in me to stumble, it would be better for him if a millstone, you know, a stone that's used for grinding grain, a large heavy stone, a donkey would be attached to this stone and have to pull it around to grind the grain. And it would be better if a millstone were hung around his neck and he were thrown into the sea. Yeah. To be salty means you're not going to cause people to sin, you're going to help the situation. If your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. It is better for you to enter into life maimed rather than having two hands to go to hell into the fire that shall never be quenched. So to have peace with each other, to be encouraging others for Christ, not causing one to sin, and not being entangled in sin myself. When someone is saved, we don't say, okay, fine, now it's okay to sin. No, you want to help each other. Okay, and so now Romans 14, verse 19, therefore, let us pursue the things which make for peace and the things by which one may edify another. And this goes along with blessed are the peacemakers. For Christian brothers and sisters to be arguing over little things, that's not right. We are to seek peace, harmony in Christ. 1 Thessalonians 5, verses 12 and 13, and we urge you, brethren, to recognize those who labor among you and are over you in the Lord and admonish you. And to esteem them very highly in love for their work's sake. Be at peace among yourselves. This is talking to the local church in the city of Thessalonica. It says, recognize them who labor among you, who are feeding you from God's word and teaching you from God's word and who are admonishing you. It says, esteem them highly in love. Because that is promoting peace amongst yourselves. Sheep without a shepherd are lost. Jesus Christ gave skills for pastors and teachers to function as his under shepherds to help feed the flock of God for spiritual benefit. And when the sheep are honoring the under shepherd, there is peace among themselves. Secondly, be committed to follow Christ. You might recognize these verses because, yes, we talked about them 2 weeks ago. Salt is good, but if the salt has lost its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? It is neither fit for the land nor for the dunghill, but men throw it out. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. So why do we say commit to Christ? Look at verse 25. It says, now great multitudes went with him, Jesus. And Jesus turned and said to them, if anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, and even his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. That was 2 weeks ago that we talked about this, Luke chapter 14, that Jesus was talking about the commitment of following Christ. And hating here does not mean I hate you, but it's a comparison, loving Christ more than family, more than my own life, being committed to follow Christ. Verse 27 says, and whoever does not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. And this relates to the saltiness. If someone has lost his salt, where's the influence? Give up, persist on following Christ all the way. And then finally, walk in wisdom and be gracious in your speaking. Colossians chapter 4, verses 5 through 6. It says, walk in wisdom toward those who are outside. So those who are in your workplace and in your family, those who are not Christians, those who are outside of the local church, walk in wisdom toward those who are outside, redeeming the time. Live in wisdom. Live in right relationships with other people. Jesus does not, you know, if I were to have my salt and then just set it on a shelf and then 50 years later pull it out and use it, that's not what Jesus does with his believers. Jesus intends to use you. He doesn't call us to salvation and then tuck us away and hide us and not use us. You are to be salt. You are to be spreading the gospel. You are to be influencing other people. And so your influence, we have to live with wisdom because we also are being influenced by the world. And we need to have wisdom to continue to live as Jesus lived. In Colossians it says, let your speech always be with grace. We're not talking about speech like I have to practice my pronunciation and my speech skills. But it's what you talk about, what you say. Let that always be seasoned with grace, with salt, that you may know how you ought to answer each one. That you're flavoring people, you're answering each person. So remember, how do you influence people? You are at peace. You live in harmony. You are at peace. And then also, you live in wisdom and you season your speech with grace. And you commit to following Christ. This is how you can continue to have influence. Continue your saltiness. Do you live at peace with others? Are you committed to following Christ? Do you live in wisdom and do you always season your speech with grace? If you have these things, then you are going to continue your influence, your salty influence. So I want to read this verse one more time in closing. It says, you and I are the salt of the earth. But if the salt loses its flavor, how shall it be seasoned? It is then good for nothing but to be thrown out and trampled underfoot by men. That's closing prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. I pray that you would help us to examine ourselves and see if we are having an influence for Christ. And if so, help us to continue that influence and how we can do that. How can we be at peace amongst ourselves and to be committed to following you? Help our lives, our actions, what we say to be done in wisdom and seasoned with grace, so that we can encourage one another to look towards Christ. I pray that you would help our lives be fully immersed and scrubbed by your word, knowing that it reveals our sin and that we can confess to you. I pray that you would help us to have the proper balance of mercy and truth. And to do that, we need to look at your perfect balance that you have. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, we'll close in one more song. We'll sing again, I Have Decided to Follow Jesus, okay?
I have decided.
protect us and preserve us in your name, that we would continue blameless until your appearing. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you.
God bless you.
Have a great week.
I think I've got it covered on girls to say goodbye.